Have you ever felt like you just don't measure up as a Christian? You just haven't achieved that level of perfection that you think a Christian should be able to attain to. Maybe some church has made you feel like you don't measure up. Maybe it's been a person that's made you feel like you don't measure up. I remember actually when I was in seminary and one of my housemates, he was attending not a very well-known Bible college, but he was in Bible college. So I thought, hey, it'd be good to have coffee. So I'm like, hey, do you want to do coffee sometime? And well, what I thought would be a nice chat over coffee ended up being more of an interrogation. And I really felt like I was interrogated by the end of it. And by the end of it, I'm not, well, he probably didn't think I was a Christian even. And if he did, he probably thought I was heretical and sinful. As for myself, I kind of thought that he was just plain weird. But there we go. Maybe we're even in that. But certainly there's one person who maybe might have made me feel like I didn't measure up as a Christian. Maybe you've had people like that in your life. Maybe you don't need any help feeling like you don't measure up as a Christian. Maybe you get there all on your own without any help. And maybe it's our passage scripture focus for today that makes you feel like you don't measure up. You know, as we read through some of the passages here, they might strike us as being, this doesn't sound like me. So let's look again at some of these verses, starting with chapter 2, verse 29. If you know that he, that is Jesus, is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who does right has been born of him. Well, as Christians, we try to do what we know is right, but sometimes we do end up doing what is wrong, don't we? And sometimes even without knowing it. But yeah, we try to do what is right. So, okay, that's okay. How about chapter 3, verse 4, though? Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he, that is Jesus, was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. Well, good so far. No one who ever abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. No one who ever abides in him sins. We believe that we're abiding in Jesus, living in Christ, but yet we still realize that we have sin in our lives. So how does that square together there? How about moving on to verse 7 here? Everyone who commits sin is a child of the devil. Oh, so we do still commit sin. Does that make us a child of the devil? How about verse 9? Those who have been born of God do not sin because God's seed abides in them. They cannot sin because they have been born of God. Okay, are we feeling discouraged yet? That we, as people who believe in Jesus, we seek to abide in Jesus and live for Jesus, and yet we recognize that there's still sin in our lives. And maybe we're discouraged by this passage of scripture that makes us feel like we don't measure up. Well, as John is writing this, he's certainly not writing it to discourage us. And as we get digging into this passage, we'll see actually that it's a great encouragement to us when we understand it properly. So let's dig into it and let's seek to understand it better and see how it would encourage us today, even if we're feeling like we don't measure up. So let's dig in. And the first thing we want to realize is that as John is writing here, just remember that we looked at this last week, how he's writing to warn the Christians in the area around where John lives in what is present day Turkey. He's writing to them to get them to realize that there are false teachers going around who say they're Christian, but they are far actually from Christian. They are ones who have taken Jesus and tried to fit Jesus into their way of thinking, as opposed to taking their way of thinking and fitting it to Jesus. And we looked at that last week. And so really they are Gnostic teachers. They're really the beginning of Gnosticism there, what's called Gnosticism, this idea of anything material is bad and evil, anything that's spiritual is good. And so there's this really sense of Gnosticism coming in and hijacking Jesus to fit their way of thinking, their way of teaching. And so John is eager that the Christians around him know that they are not to follow those false teachers. And so that teaching actually gets its way into our passage today when we look at how it speaks to the resurrection. And so, beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. Yet we do know this, that when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And so this is really speaking again to that Gnostic way of thinking. The false teachers, again, believing that anything material is bad, anything spiritual is good. They would have difficulty with this idea of God become flesh and dwelling among us. Indeed, it was John that wrote that in the Gospel of John. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The Gnostic teachers wouldn't be big on that. But also this idea of Jesus risen from the dead, bodily raised from the dead. And yet John knew Jesus. John knew Jesus to be a man, yet not just a man, God with us. John also knew, he was one of the ones who looked into the tomb and saw that the body was missing, and so realizing the bodily resurrection of Jesus, but also was with the risen Jesus, saw him eat, not acting like a ghost whatsoever, not acting like some super just spiritual entity, but rather as a person who could eat. That's good news for us at the resurrection. I look forward to chocolate. And maybe you look forward to something else. But when we are raised to life, we are raised to eternal life as in the body somehow. And so John says, what we will be, we don't know yet, but we will be like Jesus. And so John is realizing there that Jesus was raised bodily from the dead, and yet his body was different somehow. And so we look forward to that at our resurrection. So even in there, he's really speaking to that false teachers, what they're teaching. But even more important than that, John wants to get to us, to speak to us in our scripture focus today, is not only are the false teachers getting the implications of their teaching wrong, they're also getting this whole concept of how now do we live as Christ followers wrong? How do we behave? What do we do? What kind of things do we not do? How do we live as Christians? What are our ethics? And so John wants to get into how the ethics of the false teachers is way off base. And so he says to us in chapter 2, verse 29, if you know that he is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who does right has been born of him. In other words, check out the false teachers and ask yourselves, are they doing what is right? Then down to verse 4, everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed, that is, Jesus was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Everyone who commits sin is a child of the devil. So we might read that and think, oh, what about us? But as John is writing to his readers, he really wants them to reflect on these false teachers. Look at their lives. What kind of lives are they leading? What kind of lives are they teaching others to live? And we know that later Gnosticism especially would teach that because material is bad and because we look forward to what is spiritual later, then what you do in the body doesn't matter. Therefore, sin doesn't actually matter. So do what you want. Do what feels good. That was part of the Gnostic teaching. And so that kind of teaching would already be there in John's day of these false teachers saying, do what you want. Sin doesn't matter. So here comes along John and saying, reflect on these false teachers and realize what they're teaching you, that sin doesn't matter, but actually it does. And if you've been born of God, if you know the Lord, you'll know that sin matters. You will have a conscience. Your desire will be to not sin, but to do good. But look at these false teachers. That's not where they're at. So not as only is their teaching about Jesus false, they're teaching also about how to follow Jesus. That too is false. And so he sums it up there. Those who have been born of God do not sin because God's seed abides in them. They cannot sin because they have been born of God. Look again at these false teachers. They're not showing any evidence of caring about the Jesus-centered life. They have totally missed the point of Jesus teaching them to love God, love their neighbors, and love their enemies. Jesus taught that. Jesus demonstrated that and showed how to live that out through going to the cross. But these false teachers, they're completely missing all that. They're not doing what is right, but they're doing and teaching others to do indeed what is wrong. So as John is teaching us here in this passage, it's not that John is saying to the Christians that he's writing to, look at yourselves, it's quite possible that you are of the devil. even though you're trying to follow Jesus. Yeah, you're trying to follow Jesus, you believe in Jesus, but it's quite possible that you're actually of the devil. That's not what John is doing. What John is doing is saying, these false teachers, they are not of God. They are of the devil. They are trying to disrupt what God is doing. These ones are from the devil, so don't follow them. But what about you then? If these false teachers can be spoken of as being of the devil, what about the Christians John is writing to, and therefore, what about us? If we can read his letter to us too as being helpful to us. Well, let's go back then to chapter 3, verse 1. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. Who are we then? We're not those that are of the devil. We are those that are children of God. And that should take us back to Jesus' teaching about how to pray. When Jesus teaches the disciples how to pray, it pray then like this, our Father. He really wants them to have this sense of when you're speaking to the Lord and in prayer and seeking to hear from the Lord, our Father. Think of him as your heavenly Father. And also that if you look in the Gospel of Matthew, where we find the Lord's Prayer, one of the times it's also given to us in the Gospel of Luke. But in the Gospel of Matthew, it's situated within the Sermon on the Mount. And there within the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is constantly getting us back to thinking about God as our Father and wanting to be like our Father. Be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect, as he's speaking to us about loving our enemies and loving people. Be perfect, therefore, as your Father is perfect. And also, don't worry, won't your Heavenly Father take care of you? And you can read through the Sermon on the Mount there in Matthew's chapter 5, 6, 7, and really just watch out for how Jesus is speaking to the fatherhood of God to us. So here's the sense of you are those. Who are we as Christians, as Christ followers? We are the children of God. That's where we are. But the false teachers, they are not. And so naturally, as children of God, you're going to see that we are ones who we want to be followers of Jesus. We will want to be like our Heavenly Father. And so we're very much different then from these false teachers that are spoken of. And yes, we may commit sin. And so that's why it was said earlier in this letter of John, if anyone sins, our God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. So forgiveness is there. However, we, as children of God, we really want to focus in on what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus and to follow him in the way of love, in the path of love, and the path of being a good ethical person, a good behavior. And so we can think back to a sermon I preached earlier on joining Team Jesus. Yeah, that sometimes we'll mishandle the puck if we can think of being on a sports team, and the other team we'll grab that puck that we've mishandled and we'll go ahead and score on us. There's forgiveness when that happens, but we're not kicked off the team. But the important thing is that we've joined Team Jesus, that we have repented, we've made a change from being on one path, one team, to joining Team Jesus. And so that's what John is speaking to here, is you are the children of God, but watch out for those false teachers, because they are not. He'll go on to say this in verse 8, the Son of God was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. The Son of God was revealed for, that is, Jesus was revealed for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. And so when you think of what Team Jesus is about, it's about destroying the works of the devil. So look at these false teachers. They're actually looking to advance the works of the devil. When they say what you do doesn't matter, sin doesn't matter, then the works of the devil will go on. But if you're following Team Jesus, if you're following Jesus and living that life of love and you're taking your cues from God, then the works of the devil you'll be seeking to destroy. Those evil things that happen in the world, we want to stand against those evil things. And we certainly don't want to be doing those evil things ourselves. We will want to participate with God in changing the world. We know that Christ will come someday and everything will change completely, but we want to be involved now in changing the world. That's part of the reason why John also says those who have this hope in him, that is the hope of resurrection to eternal life in verse 3 there, purify themselves just as he is pure. We look forward to Jesus' return, knowing that we will see him as he is. Part of that is his purity. But we don't want to wait. We don't know what our bodies will be like then when we're raised from the dead. But we do know that we will be pure then, and we don't want to wait till then. So we want to be pure now as his children. So when John's hammering out here that those who are of the devil sin and those who are of God cannot sin, really wanting the early readers there to watch out for these false teachers. He's not wanting us as Christians today, as Jesus followers today, to have a complex about how we're not perfect. That's not what it's about. But he wants us to really enjoy being the children of God, really. And you know, as he speaks, he really does give to us the test as to, I like how the Message puts it, that Kim read to us in the scripture reading. To summarize what John is saying here, verse 10 from the Message, here's how you tell the difference between God's children and the devil's children. In other words, here's how you tell the difference between those who are actually Jesus' followers and those who are the false teachers among you trying to change you. Here's how you tell the difference. The one who won't practice righteous ways isn't from God, nor is the one who won't love brother or sister. A simple test. I love how John Peterson in the Message puts it there. A simple test. So don't just look to the teaching of the false teachers on who Jesus is, although certainly look to that, as we looked at last week. But also look at how they live and how they teach others to live. The one who won't practice righteous ways isn't from God. And that describes the false teachers, and that's not you. You know, this is Pentecost Sunday, and we might think, well, what does all this have to do with Pentecost? And yes, I'm on a sermon series through 1 John, so it doesn't necessarily line up perfectly. So the Holy Spirit isn't mentioned in the scripture reading. However, the Holy Spirit certainly is in our scripture focus when we look again at this idea of being children of God. Back to verse 1 there, see what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. And then, of course, that final verse 2, of the children of God and the children of the devil are revealed in this way. All who do not do what is right are not from God, nor are those who do not love their brothers or sisters. In other words, you are the children of God. The Holy Spirit is certainly involved in that process of becoming a child of God. And we can look to that in the book of Romans. And we look at Romans chapter 8, verse 15 says this, for you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And so there we have Paul writing to us about receiving God's Holy Spirit, and how it's through God's Holy Spirit that we can have this realization that we are, in fact, children of God. That when we have been adopted into his family, when we cry, Abba, Father, when we can really get this sense that God, yes, is our Father, and it's through Jesus Christ, his blood shed for the forgiveness of our sins, for reconciliation between us and God, It's through the Holy Spirit that we come to recognize the fatherhood of God, that he is our Father, he's our heavenly parent. And so it's the Holy Spirit is very much involved there. We are his children. And speaking of children, let's also go to a teaching in the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus says, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for it is to such as these that the kingdom of God belongs. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. Whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And when we think of that verse, we might think primarily of the innocence of children. But that may not be the first thing that we should be thinking of. I love in the Christianity Explored course how the presenter there really gets us to think about how how a little child brings nothing to the relationship. They can't bring anything. They just come to their parents. A little child has nothing to offer. And so it's really this dependence on God's grace, God's desire to be in a relationship with us. That's what it's all about. And so when we think of God inviting us to be his children, you know, let's put it this way. When we think of little children being called to the dinner table, and they come and they sit, do they sit down and think to themselves, boy, do I really deserve this dinner? I don't think too many little children think that way. But rather they just enjoy the dinner. They just enjoy what the parents have put before them. And they might even think to themselves, boy, someday I'll just love to be just like Daddy. I don't hear that so much anymore now that our boys are teenagers, but that smaller children certainly do have that sense. And this idea of, unless you're like this small child coming into the kingdom, this sense of, I bring nothing. It's all your desire, Lord, to have me as your child. I want to be like my Heavenly Father when I grow up. And so there's a sense of, as a Christian, having this sense of, we haven't grown up yet, and we still want to be like our Heavenly Father. We're still growing, and we look to grow, and it's the Holy Spirit that helps us grow. But we don't sit at the dinner table saying, oh, I don't deserve this, therefore, I wonder what my standing is before God. You know, no, when you're sitting at the table of the Lord, you don't wonder what your standing is before God. When you're sitting at the dinner table of the Lord, you know what your standing is before God. You have been welcomed to his table. And we have, through the blood of Jesus Christ shed for the forgiveness of our sins, we have been invited to the table through the Holy Spirit's work in us. And the Holy Spirit is still working in us to make us more and more like our Heavenly Father. We have been invited. We have been welcomed. So do you have the sense of, I just don't measure up? Well, you don't, and neither do I, but that's okay, because we're growing. The question isn't, have you measured up? The question is, has he who has measured up done something that makes it possible for you to be sitting at the table of God? And that is Jesus. He measures up, and he has done something, given his life at the cross for the forgiveness of our sins, for reconciliation with God, that we're invited to the table. We can come, and his Holy Spirit's given to us, and we're growing, but we're invited to the table as little children who can bring nothing, but don't need to question, do we measure up? Have you come to the table?